Emma, I don't know how many videos did we do, like four now, the
Four?
fourth, yeah, the fourth,
Four.
yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So you mentioned several times that you work on design systems. Like, call me ignorant. What is a design system?
So that's a lot. There's a lot I could go into here. So I'm going to give you an example. So when you use a Google product, you know it's a Google product, even if you don't see the logo, right? It looks and feels like Google. The interactions speak to their brand. And design systems help convey a brand identity through all products in a suite of products. So Google has a lot of products. We've got Google Flights. We have just plain Google, Google Maps. They all look and feel the same. And design systems really help with that. So they encapsulate your brand identity within everything, within your design components, within your coded components. So there's no industry definition of a design system, which is why it's kind of hard to define. In my opinion, it's a combination of your designed components, whether that's in Illustrator, whether that's in Sketch or Figma, and your foundational principles. So how you treat accessibility or the color palettes that you're using and your type scales, all the way to your coded components. So having a centralized repository of components, whether that's React, Vue, basic web components, all of the above, and your brand is represented all the way through. And it helps promote consistency such that, in a large company that has multiple products, like IBM or like Google, it looks and feels like them.
That, but huge. That's huge. Isn't it overwhelming
It
for
is.
companies to start caring about that?
Absolutely. Oh, totally.
That's why
And
you, yeah.
yeah, well, it's normal for large companies to have dedicated teams. The problem is like getting the resources and proving to your stakeholders that this is important and it will ultimately save you money. It'll save as developers, like it's impossible to learn everything. So some developers struggle to understand accessibility or other things. And having a centralized repository of components that they can pull from is great for many reasons, one of which is onboarding. So if I have multiple product development teams, I can take, a person from squad A and put them on squad B, and there's no discrepancy in the tooling that they're using.
And then the result and the quality that they are
Right.
providing,
And
right?
a lot of the difficult decisions are already made for them, in terms of like, okay, I need to build a fully custom accordion. It takes a long time to do that, especially to ensure full accessibility compliance.
It's hard to build an
It's really
accordion. I mean, it
hard.
looks simple, and people say, "Oh, it's just this,
Right.
CSS class you put on the active one, and that's it."
Right.
But what about the different states? How can you go into wrong state? There are so many things you care about. Do you want to open one, close the other? There are
Yeah.
so many aspects about
There's a
it.
lot, yeah, and often design gets lost in translation, and so the designs that a designer would provide have to be very detailed, very redlined, which is extremely time consuming. So I think the goal here is to get design and engineering to work more closely together to kind
Right.
of get rid of that overhead. And then you build it once, you build it right. It takes longer, but in the long run, it's essentially like a rubber stamp. You build it once, you can just stamp it anytime you need a new component.
The problem is that what you're saying here, it's hard to estimate the benefit for the cost, because
Yeah.
you're saying, okay, I'm going to hire people to only do that
Yep.
for a long time. It takes a long time to do a design system,
Yes.
and you need to see the results of your plan, and it takes a long time to see these results,
Well, there are
right?
some metrics that you can use. So one that we're using is how much code have we deleted from our products as a result of having a centralized repository? How much has our like we used to rely on big third-party frameworks and libraries. Well, how much has the dependency on that been reduced? Like how
Why do you need to reduce that kind of dependency?
Well, if we have to import the entire Bootstrap library for one small thing, the performance payoff is not great. Versus if we build it once as a custom component, it can save a lot in performance.
Right. And getting back to the, so basically what we understand often with design system is that it's about design, whereas it's not exactly about that. It's not
No.
only about that.
Yeah.
It's not about the colors alone. I mean, color palettes are part
Right.
of it, but there are a lot of other things. One of the things you mentioned is that you want to deliver the same experience in different terms,
Right.
including accessibility. And if you do it in a design system, then developers will be able to do it even if they don't
Right.
have a lot of experience in accessibility.
Right. Right. It's the same with motion design. Like, incorporating animation into your products and doing micro interactions is not something that every developer is going to know about. If you put that in a centralized repository, anyone can learn and benefit from it.
Right. And you know, also, well, both are very complicated aspects because, you know, I mean, motion design, I mean, animations that you're going to put and accessibility, because they need a lot of testing on different browsers.
Yeah.
And also they're quite deep, even if you, in the surface, you think mm-hmm. they are. Now, if people think of accessibility, oh, let's put Alt on images and that's, we're
right.
done. And it's
or
way
Aria on that. Everything.
Yeah. Yeah, but yeah. It's a much deeper thing than that. And it's a profession. You know, we're working on some components that we want to provide open source. And then we said, okay, we need to make them accessible mm-hmm. because maybe we'll help our users to kind of, you know, get that out of the box so mm-hmm. that they don't have to code it. And then we started developing it at our team, and then we understood how ignorant yeah. we are about yeah. that kind of topic, and we had to hire someone.
I know.
Actually, Sarah Swaydan, I don't know if you know her,
yeah.
but we had to work with her because we understood how ignorant we are on the topic. And like, I was with
mm-hmm.
all the team, and I was like, who can do it? Like,
right.
we can try, but it's really harder than you
yeah.
think. It's a lot of testing and a lot of aspects.
Right.
So that part, if you centralize it,
yeah.
then you're guaranteed, I mean, you have more guarantees right. than your system overall will benefit from that,
yeah.
every single project.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
Cool. So now, is it the kind of project that you do, design systems?
Yes.
Like,
so
you manage that project, you start that project.
So there was, it was called a design system before, but it was missing the coded components. And so, you know, the company had one, they were working on it. But I did notice there was no code. There were no engineers working on it. It was solely a design product, which is totally fine. If you can even centralize your designs, that's a great step. And so at that point I said, well, we need this. You know, LogMeIn has a large portfolio of products, and the goal is to have them all be consistent. And so I said, we need to make this a real system. And so I got moved on almost a year ago now, in I think January, February of this year. And while I am an engineer, I think my role has kind of morphed into more of a project manager. I am building our style guide using Gatsby. But other than that, I don't develop coded components. I work with our engineering teams and our design team to ensure that things are running smoothly. So it's more project management. Yeah.
but if you're starting, well, first of all, like it's maybe this is the right time for these kind of things
mm-hmm.
because first designer and developers, they were so much in different worlds.
Mm-hmm.
Like, oh, here's what you have to do. And then the developers have to figure out things. And the communication was very complicated.
Right.
And I guess maybe components
mm-hmm.
brought that kind of same vocabulary
yes.
to be able to talk about things, you
mm-hmm.
know, like now designers understand how, you know, and you kind of, you get them in parallel. It's not because you get components in React that designers were, or you know, different JavaScript frameworks that designers start getting interested.
Mm-hmm.
You get Sketch, which
yeah.
start having symbols, and
mm-hmm.
symbols are components, and they start evolving in parallel
mm-hmm.
in the same direction without maybe too much communication in the beginning. And now
right.
it's getting like the full story, it makes a lot of sense, right?
And we also kind of forget that as a front-end developer, you should have some basic foundational design skills to a certain extent. Like, if we expect our designers to have some foundational understanding of what HTML, CSS, and JavaScript are, we also have a responsibility to understand the fact that type scales exist, and we can't just go throwing like 35 pixels on our header text to make it bigger. So there are it definitely forged better communication. Tools like Framer X have come out too, which are really great because we do.
I don't know the tools. So,
what
is it?
It's meant for prototyping, if I'm not mistaken. So,
what is it? Which one?
Framer X.
Okay.
So basically, you can write React components without having to know code, but you can also write them in code in their UI, which is really cool. So it's for designers with you know, base level of development, which a lot of them do have a foundational level of development skills, and we kind of take that for granted. They can go in and actually like tweak the JSX code and understand like how that impacts the UI, and you can create animations essentially along timelines without having to know how to code, but you can also code with it.
Is it different from something like Storybook?
Storybook is mostly for coding and documenting your components versus FrameworkX is simply a prototyping tool for building prototypes. Like, I think you can import your sketch components and then actually, like, you can use the UI to animate them, but you can also go and actually edit their React code. So it's really neat. I'd recommend checking it out. I don't know all the nuances of it because I was still just getting into it, but essentially it's helping prototype in code. So like your prototypes are no longer throwaway, they're actually being used. And that's another thing design systems can help with is once you have these components, you can actually prototype in code with them, show your clients like working code and actually use them in production.
Yeah, this is improves a lot the collaboration. Now, if you got to start with a design system, what do you start with? What is the first thing? You're like, there's nothing and you're starting now.
It depends. So, I mean, I guess my first question is, why are you learning design systems? Because you don't necessarily need one. And I think, you know, it's a hot topic at the moment. But if you are building a small application, you don't necessarily need a design system. You might want to centralize your design decisions or, you know, your components, but you won't need a fully fledged design system necessarily. So if I'm an engineer and I want to look into it, maybe I'll focus on how do I build extensible React components? Like, what are the things that I can do? To the point, like Jen, Jen Creighton has a great talk about flexible React components, because often we hear components and we want to make them extensible and have everything customizable within boundaries, but that leads to an absurd amount of props that get passed to React. Like, how do we avoid the apocalypse is what she discusses. So I would say learning how to build robust components that are customizable, but customizable in a sense that we provide, the whole goal is to be consistent, right? So I might have three different sizes of buttons and I'll provide those three sizes. So it's customizable within those ranges. How do you build a component like that that's accessible and customizable without being just a mess of props? So I would say that, and then looking at a storybook would be a great method as well.
So do I understand right? You're more for like giving options, but not giving like full flexibility on the component.
You have to provide boundaries. We need flexibility so we're not contained. Like if we put too strict of boundaries on it, you're not going to be able to ideate and actually build something useful necessarily. But we don't want to let our engineering teams or our design teams run wild, because that's how you get an inconsistent suite of products. So you have to provide parameters for these things.
Right. And what about like the dependencies? So imagine you have these components, they're centralized, but they're used in different apps, different websites. How do you manage after that? Like whenever you have to kind of maintain or evolve components, and you have all that kind of different things that are depending on these kind of components.
Yeah, so the way we've done it is, I think we have three products that are working on our system to help build it. There are several different team structures. I think Nathan Curtis is a great resource. He has a ton of Medium blogs, and he talks about different models for developing systems. I think one of them is a federated system where you have a centralized core team whose main job it is to build the system, but you also have like input and output from the larger community of within your products. And so what we do is I'm kind of leading the direction of the system, but it's really being built by the core teams. So we have people from each product. We work with them directly to say, hey, like, this is the upcoming change. You're going to have to implement it, or it's going to break these things, or why is this not a good decision? Should we move forward with it? And having input from a core team is going to be invaluable, because you never know the implications of the decisions that you're going to make. So getting the feedback from all these people is going to be really useful without being overwhelming from talking with 300 people in a Slack channel.
So basically saying that it's not that because you did the design system with a different team, they should completely cut communication with the other teams. You need to kind of keep some kind of committee of people from different products and projects.
Yeah.
So that whenever you're changing a component, they can like discuss it. Okay, we're going to do that. What do you think are the impacts from at your
that works for side. Us, right? That's seemingly the best tactic that we have thus far, because you have to remember we're building a product for products. And so our main stakeholders are our product teams. And so we need to have good communication.
And like budget wise, how do you deal with, like, if someone has today, they believe completely what you're saying and they believe in it, they want to do a design system, but how can they sell it? How because there's no budget, right? Mm-hmm. The budget does not exist. You have to create a budget. Yeah. It doesn't exist on its own. It's not related to any of the projects. Mm-hmm. It's something on the side, right?
How can you justify
the budget?
It's really hard, and I think you have to prove your value and show them what they could have if they give you more. So
Who do you talk to? One example project, or do you
go so to the... We started this conversation with my first line manager because I'm the only dedicated person full time, and it's been really hard because we have so much momentum and we want to build so many amazing things, but we don't have 100% dedicated designers or developers. I think it's been about a year now we've been fully trying to build this, and communicating our progress has been really helpful, and kind of trying to establish a roadmap is going to be helpful too, because at that point they can see where we plan to go, what are our plans with this, and it's not just an open-ended project, right? We want this to be viewed as a product, and it's going to take time to build up that level of respect, but small wins I think are really important to communicate. So taking screenshots of the before and after for the amount of code that we removed, and taking screenshots or video captures, like screen captures of your components being used in a product, and discussing with your engineering teams how much faster it was for them to build a feature because some of the components were already built for them, and taking those small wins and communicating them at a high level and saying, this is what we built with, you know, a designer who's 15% dedicated, or an engineer who has 10% dedication time. Imagine what we could do if we had 100% dedication.
So basically, you're saying the first thing is that you need to kind of show that it's a useful product and it's not an open-ended product. So there are deliveries, there are iterations.
Correct.
And there are results. And you show these results. Look, this happened. Mm-hmm. And this is how you do the selling of the project. Right. They're like, look, there are actual results now. We did small iteration. Now if we do one second iteration, things will be even better, right?
Right.
And you install it slowly with results.
Right.
So commit at, you know, delivering more often so that it justifies the investment.
Yeah, what absolutely. Saying, right? Yeah.
Okay, cool. Any other things that you think about when talking about design system that people should, I don't know, understand or make sure not to get wrong?
I don't think there's a right and a wrong way to necessarily build a system. I think a design system is so open-ended that almost anything can be, you know, perceived as a design system. So, you know, take everything I'm saying with a grain of salt. And I think if you're kind of wondering whether or not you need one, I feel like oftentimes the right answer is not necessarily, at least not a fully fledged system. It's for those big enterprise companies that you would typically need a fully fledged design system. But Chris Coyer wrote a great article on CSS tricks about who are design systems for, because we see all these large companies open sourcing their code. And the answer is they're for the companies themselves. Like, I could technically go and fork IBM Carbon and use it, or, like, you know, include it in my project and style everything like IBM Carbon. Would I do that? Probably not. But they open source it to share knowledge. And I think if you're building a design system and you have struggles or you have successes, like, share that with the community, because it's such a new field that we really need those things.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Well, thank you very much.